Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Eternity Artifact by L. E. Modesitt, Jr., narrated by Jeffrey Kafer and Cindy Kay. Love of knowledge is the basis of all scholarship and lies eternally at the root of the tree of civilization. The eternal love of God surpasses all other loves and is to be valued above all worldly and other transient affections. Love is a delusion, an eternal romanticization of lust perpetuated by oversexed males. A true artist's love of life, of the endless and eternal, and all that it encompasses, is expressed in every brushstroke. What separates artifices and artifacts from mere assemblages of components, what defines them and their use, is the love with which they are constructed and applied. Preface. The last and most unusual discovery of the ill-fated and underfunded deep space exploration program of the League of Worlds was Kronos. See B-squared, DSE Section 4-1, Galactic Anomalies. Kronos is a perfect sphere of compressed matter in a state that appears as neither regular matter nor that which would be classified as neutronium. Its diameter is 15,020 kilometers, 1.178 t-norm, with an approximate mass of 1.9714 times 10 to the 15th kilograms. Density is roughly 280 t-norm. Remote tests and probes indicate no atmosphere, and a surface that is perfectly polished, variation less than 1/10,000th of a millimeter, under a thin layer of galactic dust and detritus. Kronos rotates on its own axis with a period of 11 standard hours. Based on the accumulation and composition of surface matter, the trajectory of the body, the images and sensor readings, the DSE team estimated that Kronos had been formed between 4 and 10 billion years ago. This preliminary finding ignited controversies in all major systems and two other brief expeditions, see Covenant Rim Expedition and CW Kronos Probe, were mounted. Their instrumentation was less elaborate, but essentially confirmed the findings of the DSE expedition. Equally remarkable is the body's location and velocity. Kronos was detected beyond the outer edge of the trailing arm of the galaxy, moving at a 30-degree inclination to the galactic ecliptic and tangent to the arm at a constant velocity of 66 kilometers per second. Because of its speed and gravitational characteristics, confirmation of its properties was both difficult and costly, and those expenses were a major factor in the termination of the DSE program. After the initial furor over the findings of all three expeditions, all the systems of the galaxy abandoned the enigma that was Kronos to its lonely journey, citing the difficulties and costs involved in further explorations. Universe of Wonder. J. Joshua Morty, Director of Science, Pan Media, Delhi, OE, 4323. Prologue. Goodman. Tianku Wong stepped onto the dais and crossed to the podium. Podiums haven't been necessary in millennia except for symbolic reasons, but symbols are critical to humanity, whatever the culture. From where I stood on the west side of the dais with a half squad of white guards, Ku Wong would be less than 10 meters away. The Hall of Deliberation was hushed as the recently elected People's Advocates of the Middle Kingdom waited to hear him. I already knew the basis of his address and the policies he intended to follow as First Advocate. That was why I was there. My hands felt like they were sweating under the pseudo-handful gloves that ran from fingernails to elbow. So did my face, under the real flesh that wasn't my own. The sweating was an illusion, not from nervousness, but from a systemic reaction to the nanothin layer between my flesh and the foreign DNA of the arm gloves and head flesh. With the other white guards, I remained perfectly motionless. Ku Wong stepped behind the podium. The front was carved in the likeness of a spray of bamboo stalks behind the seal of the Middle Kingdom. He let the silence draw out before he spoke. The instalinguistic made what he said intelligible, but that was only because I'd had practice. Years of it. Speaking was still easier than comprehending. The people of the Middle Kingdom have made their wishes known, and you are here on Tiananmen to enact the laws and policies necessary. The election has made it clear that the Middle Kingdom must be run on principles of enlightened humanism and secularism, and not by the dead hands of ancient prophets and barbaric gods. In an age of enlightenment, and we of the Middle Kingdom are indeed blessed to live in such an age, there is no place for religious and cultural paternalism. There is no place for unbridled feministic anarchy. There is no place for unfettered capitalism, nor for dictatorial government command and control. Most important, there is no place for the worship of power for the sake of power. We will continue to oppose all the ancient evils, whether based on superstition and blind belief, or upon unchecked power and greed. We will oppose such policies and beliefs, both within our worlds and without, and we will stand firm against those who would force such upon us, or who would endeavor to seduce us with poetic polemics of the past. A roar of applause filled the hall. I had no doubt that Ku Wong's words sounded better in their original Mandarin, but the insta-linguistics were accurate enough. I waited for the next round of applause. In the course of human events, each people has the choice of whether the day ahead will be a bright tomorrow or a faded yesterday chained by memories of a despotic past. The worlds of the Middle Kingdom have chosen tomorrow, unlike those of Covenanters, who have proved that they will drag all around them, such as the ill-fated Librocracy, into a despotic religious tyranny, or those of the Alliance. Tomorrow will be ours. Just before the applause rose to the highest point, I twisted my hand slightly. The miniature nanodarts flashed unseen across the space that separated me from the first advocate. He paused, looking surprised.
Will be ours, for we have prepared.
A few in the front row, the new ministers, leaned forward. Ku Wong never stuttered. Abruptly, a pillar of flame flared where he had stood. It was so hot the podium turned black even before the pyrotic darts finished their reactive consumption. The darts had been so small and so comparatively slow that the kinetic energy screens had not been triggered. The multiple micro-launchers in my uniform had disintegrated, and the residue would show nothing. For less than a second, the hall of deliberation was still. Then chaos erupted.
Covenanters! Murder!
With the other guards, I dashed forward. We formed a barrier around the ashes that had been the first advocate of the Middle Kingdom. Nanetic barriers dropped into place, separating the dais from the hall proper.
White guards, reform on the wings!
The commands came from nowhere, but the voice was that of General Sei Sung, the advocate of security. We reformed. Energy fields flashed over and around us. I waited as hard-faced men and women in brilliant white appeared with the shoulder braids of security on their single suits. One team appeared to my right.
Lao Shun, forward!
Shun stepped forward. The security specialists aimed scanners and analyzers at him. The head analyst nodded.
To the right, wait there. Chou Wong, forward!
I stepped forward. The analyzers took minute samples from the backs of my wrists and cheeks and neck. The only weak points for my visible body parts were my eyes themselves, but the politics of scanning eyes had limited DNA sampling there and retinal scans.
Claire, step to the right.
I formed up next to Lao Shun. Neither of us spoke. For the next 2 hours, the security specialists scanned everything and everyone. The scans were not only for DNA, but for internal weapons. The scan showed that I was Chou Wong and that I had no internal weapons or anomalies. That was as it should have been. All I had to do was to remain calm and carry out the duties of the guard I had removed and replaced. To do otherwise would have called attention to who I was, and would have been as fatal to me as my nanodarts had been to the first advocate. Another 2 standard hours and 2 more screenings passed before we were dismissed and confined to quarters. This mission had been completed satisfactorily. Getting back to New Zion would be tedious, but not a real problem. While the universe might suspect that the Council of 12 had decreed the first advocate's death, no proof of my actions or identity could be traced to the Council. Even if I were caught, the automatics would ensure no evidence would remain, and that was another reason why I planned most carefully. If that failsafe had not existed, the results would have been catastrophically embarrassing to the Council. In some senses, an operative's easiest tasks were the missions. In working for the Council, the members and their personal crusaders were more dangerous to you than the operatives of other governments. As I waited for the opportunity to leave the barracks, I couldn't help but wonder what the next assignment would be. seeking. 1. Fitzhugh. At times, every professor believes that his classroom represents the abnegation of intelligence, if not absolute abiosis. This feeling has been universe-wide since long before the Tellurian diaspora. Lufde was no exception, especially not for my fourth-period class, Historical Trends 1001, the introductory course, one of the core requirements for undergraduates. I walked through the door into the small amphitheater classroom and toward the dais. 40 bodies sat waiting in 4 tiers arrayed in a semicircle, all avoiding my scrutiny. At times such as the one before me, I could only wish that the university did not require all full professors to teach one introductory course every year at a bare minimum. I'd drawn fourth period right after lunch, and that made it even more of a challenge. I stationed myself behind the podium, the representation of a practice significantly untransformed in almost 10,000 recorded years of human history, and for the last 5, savants and pedants had prognosticated the decline of personal and physical presence classroom instruction. Yet in all instances where such ill-considered experimentation and technologically based pedagogical methodology had been attempted in an effort to replace what had worked, if imperfectly, the outcomes and the ramifications had ranged from social catastrophe to unmitigated disaster, even as my predecessors in pedagogy had predicted such eventualities. Technology and implementation had never constituted the difficulty, but rather the genetic and physiological strengths and limitations of human cognitive and learning patterns. From a historical perspective, successful technological applications are those that enhance human capacities, not those that force humans into pre-structured technological niches or functions. As I cleared my throat and stepped to the podium, the murmurs died away. I glanced down at the shielded screen before picking a name, smiling politely and speaking. Scholar Finzel, please identify the single most critical aspects of the events leading to the Sunnite Covenanter conflagration of 3237.
Sir?
Finzel offered a blank look. For the second class of the first semester, blank looks were not exactly infrequent, not for beginning students, especially for those from non-shielded continents or from the occasional off-planet scholar. I realize neolatry precludes your interest in matters of past history, but since the conflagration resulted in the devastation of Meath, extensive damage to the Celtic worlds of the Comity, and significant taxation increases for the entire Comity, and since both the Covenanters and the Alliance have continued to rearm and rebuild their fleets, with a continued hostility exemplified most recently by the so-called pacification of the Mazarine systems and the forcible annexation of the Walden Librocracy. That not-so-gentle reminder did not remove the expression of incomprehension, but only added one of veiled hostility. I used the screen to check his background. As I'd vaguely recalled, he was from Ulster, where he could have netlinked and been provided the answer. Scholar Finzel, I said politely. Gregory is a shielded continent, and the university is a shielded institution. You're expected to read the texts before class. For some reason, you seem unable to comprehend this basic requirement. I suggest you remedy the situation before the next class. I turned to a student with a modicum of interest in her eyes. Scholar McAfee. According to Roberts and Janes, sir, there were 2 linked causes of the conflagration. The first was the malfunction of the communications linkages of the Covenanter Fleet Command, and the second was the widespread perception among the population of the Alliance worlds that the Covenanters intended to spread a nanogenovirus that would transform all herbivores into hogs. A hint of a smile crossed Scholar McAfee's lips. "You're in the general area," I replied, "but I don't believe that Jane said the Covenanter Fleet's command communications malfunctioned. Do you recall exactly what he wrote?" McAfee frowned. Anyone else?
Sir?
The tentative voice was that of Ariel Leonore, a dark-haired young woman who looked more like a girl barely into seminary rather than at university. Yes?
I think, didn't he write something? It was more like the expectations of instantaneous response resulted in the ill-considered reprisal on Hajj Majora. And that the reprisal made the Sunnis so angry that they passed the legislation funding the High Caliph's declaration of jihad. There were rumors about the Spear of Iblis, but those were non-causal.
Leonore paused, her voice trailing away. Very good, Scholar Leonore.
I stopped and surveyed the faces, seeing that most of them still hadn't grasped the impact of James's words. The expectations of instantaneous response, what does that mean? All 40 faces were blank with the impermeability of incomprehension. When I had been in the service, I had believed such an expression was limited to those of less than advanced intelligence. The years in academia had convinced me that it appeared upon the visages of all too many individuals in the adolescent and post-adolescent years, regardless of innate intelligence or the lack thereof. What it means, I drew out the words, is that instantaneous communications and control preclude the opportunity for considered thought and reflection. The Covenanter command had the ability to order and carry out an immediate reprisal. They did so. They did not think about the fact that the Covenanter trading combines on Hajj Majora had, within the terms of their culture, acted responsibly against those Covenanters who had manipulated the terms of exchange in a manner that could be most charitably described as fraud. I cleared my throat. There are definite disadvantages to auditory lectures, especially without even sonic boosting. But my discomfort was irrelevant to those who had enacted the shielding compact. Now that you know that, why did I initially suggest that there was only one critical aspect to these events?
You suggest that both events listed by James share a commonality, sir.
That was Scholar Amala Sukaril, one of the three exchange students from the worlds of the Middle Kingdom.
Not only the events cited by James, but those cited by Yamato and Alarif.
Isn't it communications? They all deal with communications, sir, suggested Leonore. Young Ariel might have been tentative, but at least she was thinking, unlike most of the others.
Exactly. Both the events cited by James were the result of misunderstanding and misapplications of the use and function of communications, if in different societal aspects. If you apply the same tests to the examples of Yamato and Alarif, you'll find a similar pattern.
I smiled, not that I wanted to, because it was likely to be a long afternoon. History illustrates a pattern in communications. In low-tech civilizations, only immediate personal communications can be conveyed with any speed, and those are often without detail. As more detail is required, communications slow. As technology improves, there is always a trade-off between speed and detail, because improving technology results in greater societal and infrastructural complexity, which requires greater detail. Until the development of full-band comm and nanoprocessing, this trade-off existed to a greater or lesser degree. For the past millennium or so, however, the limitation on communications has not been the technology. What has it been? I surveyed the faces, some beginning to show apprehension as they realized that they did not know the answer and that I might indeed call upon them.
Would it be understanding, sir? Ventured Sukaril.
Precisely. Just because you have the information and even 100-year instantaneous analyses doesn't mean that you truly know what to do with it, particularly when the analyses may be conflicting, depending on the background assumptions and the weight of the evidence. This was particularly true in the case of the conflagration, because of the cultural imperatives of both the Covenanters and the Alliance. Even today, any analyses dealing with the interaction of those cultures are problematical.
Sir, why does it matter that much?
That was from Emery David. The Comity has 1,000 world members, and the Covenanters have less than 200. There can't be more than 70 Alliance worlds.
What is the first rule of interstellar warfare? I replied.
No planet can be effectively defended against a determined attack,
sir,
replied Scholar David.
And what are the beliefs behind a jihad?
Finally, comprehension began to illuminate a few faces.
You mean, sir, that they don't care because they'll go to paradise?
Or heaven if they're covenanters doing the will of the divine and seeking to ensure that we do not recover the morning star, I replied dryly.
But that's a myth without foundation.
I cannot ascertain the source of that incredulous murmur.
Not to true believers, it is not even in this so-called enlightened and rational times, and certainly not upon the worlds of the covenant. The morning star, or the spear of Iblis, the hammer of Lucifer, whatever the specific term, is a symbol of forbidden knowledge, knowledge that is considered only the province of Iblis, Satan, or their demon children. If there is one aspect of all true believer religions that remains constant across time and history,
It is that certain aspects of technology or science are forbidden by the deity because use of that knowledge usurps the powers and privileges of the deity. Such theocracies will therefore commit great violence over issues or scientific practices that would appear common to many of you. I inhaled slowly for a pause. With regard to this, even if the Comity is more secular in outlook, once the theocracies have used force against our interests, such actions require force in response, or the perception of weakness will cost even more in the long run. We lost the populations of 10 worlds. The Covenanters lost 30 and the Alliance nearly 40. It has taken close to 10 centuries for them to recover, half that for us, except that a dead world remains that for longer than we or any other humans will be around to recolonize. 100 worlds scoured. Would you like it to happen again on Ulster or Lear, or perhaps Culain or Liadin? I paused. Or perhaps the Covenanters are somewhat sensitive to the power of position, in which case, what happens to be the other leading secular polity, the one with whom they share the closest stellar congruencies? The Middle Kingdom? Correct. Now, my skepticism is almost without limby, but most recently the first advocate of the Middle Kingdom died in circumstances resembling assassination, right after he had delivered a series of addresses severely critical of the theocratic expansionism of the world of the Covenant. What might happen if the Middle Kingdom were reputed to obtain some forbidden knowledge, something resembling the Spear of Iblis? To borrow an ancient metaphor, how long before the sabers began to rattle? Again, just over, if you will, information. There was silence in the room, although I could hear someone murmur, "It couldn't happen again." I refrained from suggesting all too many people, particularly politicians, had said those words, or some variation, over hundreds of centuries, generally to everyone's regret. Now, I'd like each of you to take a moment to reflect. I would like each of you to come up with an example from history where information and how it was handled was critical in determining the fate of something, an army, a fleet, a nation, a world. I held up a hand to forestall the objections. I know. Once you're away from Gregory, you can netlink and get a reply, ordered by whatever parameters you suggest. The point of this exercise is to develop your judgment so that when you do that in the future, you will have a greater understanding of what that information actually means. This time, the majority of expressions were those of resignation. I suppose that was an improvement. If they thought what I was requiring was difficult, they hadn't even considered what was going to be required in the later stages of applied manual mathematics. I'd learned years earlier that if I leaned on the students hard in the opening classes, the classes got easier and more rewarding toward the end. Unfortunately, doing so and maintaining a cheerful demeanor in the process was arduous in the first weeks of the semester. I didn't quite breathe a sigh of relief when fourth period was over and I left the classroom, walking down the ramp to the main level. There were times I could feel my hands tightening, wanting to throttle certain students. The best ones cared for knowledge as a tool, and the worst only sought a degree with marks that would guarantee entry into some multi or another, or into the Comity bureaucracy, which was worse, from what I had seen, than that of academia. I could not help but wish at times that I were back teaching in the days prior to the diaspora on old Earth, where everything had been broadband and without the direct face-to-face student contact that reminded me all too often of how little most of them cared for knowledge itself. But that time on old Earth had been before the discovery of the subtle but far-reaching effects of broadcast energies, even at extraordinarily low power, on neonatal and prematuration mental development. The Comity had banned wide-scale public and private broadcast of information and power, and relied on monoptic distribution systems, unlike the more conservative governments such as the Covenanters and Sunnite Alliance, for whom cost-benefit analyses included individuals with environmentally damaged attention spans. I couldn't help but snort to myself. My students had short enough attention spans without additional technological assistance in shortening them further. The continent of Gregory, as many other continents on Comity worlds, had even more stringent requirements than the baseline regulations enforced throughout the entire Comity of worlds. Once back in my office, little more than an overlarge closet 3 meters on a side, I settled myself behind my console and keyed in the codes to call up my incoms. There were no personal direct links at the university, or for that matter anywhere on the continent.
The first message was from the provost, just a message and no text. Congratulations on being nominated for a senior fellowship with the Comity Diplomatic Corps. Your continued diligence in seeking outside validation and recognition of your talents, accomplishments, and credentials has not gone unnoticed. I just looked at the message. The last thing I wanted was a senior fellowship with the CDC. Years back, my service tours had convinced me of the futility of government service. I certainly had not applied for such a fellowship. Had the provost nominated me? Why? Had I been that much of a thorn in his bureaucratic side? It didn't matter. In the unlikely event I happened to be selected, I'd politely refuse. There were more than enough brilliant junior professors who wanted such empty honors and would be happy to accept. I moved to the next message. 2. Goodman. The 5-story building in New Jerusalem was identified as the Zion Mercantile Exchange. It wasn't, although there were legitimate trade and commerce offices on the main level. At the end of the East Corridor, I stepped through the gate to the lifts, cleared by a minute sample of my true DNA. My destination was on the second level. At the third doorway on the second level, I offered my wrist once more to the DNA coder. Request clearance codes. Kappa 7896, Josiah 3, Walls of Jericho, Hattusa version. John Paul Goodman cleared. The Endurasteel portal irised open, long enough for me to enter one of the sanctums of the Covenant Intelligence Service. One of Colonel Truesdale's bright young men looked up from his console at me. The Colonel will be with you in a few minutes, Operative Goodman. I was a senior CIS operative, not just an operative. I didn't correct him. Instead, I settled into one of the straight-back chairs to wait. 14.5 minutes passed before the aide said pleasantly, "You can go in now, Operative Goodman." "Thank you." I offered a warm smile and walked through the door that opened as I neared and closed behind me. The inner office looked to have a panoramic view of New Jerusalem through a wide expanse of glass. That was an illusion. 2 men awaited me. Colonel Truesdale sat behind a table desk, and a dark-skinned man with gray hair sat in a chair to his left facing me. Colonel Truesdale's eyes were hard and glittering blue. They didn't match the genial laugh and the warmth of his voice. "Operative Goodman, you've heard of Major Bio." I nodded politely. "Yes, sir." Who hadn't after his exploits in pacifying the Nubian cluster, or rooting out the followers of the anti-prophet among the Mazarines? He hadn't had much to do in the ongoing annexation of the Walden Librocracy. He wouldn't have been needed. The Waldonians didn't believe enough in anything to fight that hard. "Take a seat." I sat in the remaining chair. Major Ibio's dark eyes scrutinized me from an even darker face. After a moment he spoke. "The Comity is undertaking an unusual expedition. They have refitted a former colony supply ship. The Magellan is the largest possible vessel that can fit through a gate. The AG drives are the most powerful ever installed and have been under construction for the past 3 years. The shuttles are larger than couriers. The vessel is heavily shielded and armed with the weaponry of a standard Comity battlecruiser, and it will be part of a scientific expedition." A colony vessel with beefed-up drives armed like a battlecruiser for a science expedition? That made no sense. Why were they giving me that kind of mission? What I knew about any science besides weapons and the general basics wouldn't enable me to pass for a lab tech, much less a scientist. Or was it a way to get rid of me? "The Comity government has seldom invested heavily in any research exploration, but it seems more than probable that their scientists have located a planet with alien forerunner technical artifacts or a renegade technocrat colony that escaped the dirty war then failed." Ibio smiled coldly. "You understand the possible value. In thousands of years, no one has found any alien artifacts, not anywhere in the galaxy. It's unlikely that any of the renegade technocrat scientists escaped." "Exactly." Ibio's voice was colder than before. "The Comity would not expend such funding if they were not absolutely certain. They may even be seeking the Morning Star." The legendary Hammer of Lucifer, the Spear of Iblis, had they ever even existed? I wasn't about to ask that question. "I'll do whatever's required, sir, but I'm not a scientist. Your job is both simple and very difficult," interrupted the colonel. He smiled warmly once more. We don't expect you to bring back scientific discoveries or artifacts. That would be asking far too much of any operative. That didn't reassure me much. What you are to do is to leave an AG signaler that will allow our ships to locate the planet or station or locale independently. AG signalers didn't exactly float in orbit off strange planets. That I knew, but I wouldn't have recognized one if it had been set before me. Needless to say, you cannot carry such aboard the Magellan. That means you'll have to build it from scratch. I was getting a very bad feeling about what the Colonel had in mind. We don't intend to confront the Comity directly. That would be unwise, but it is difficult to monitor an entire planet, even for the DSS. The Colonel smiled once more. You'll be given an in-depth indoctrination for both your cover and for your mission. Your cover will provide you access to the equipment you need. You will spend the next month in a regime of forced nanite education and indoctrination. By then, you'll look and act like your cover. More surgery and forced nanite education? What stories I'd heard about them hadn't been good. How many operatives are you putting through this? Truesdale ignored the question. You will be William Gerald Bond, Comity Armorer Second Class. He has been assigned to the Magellan, but will be late in reporting for cadre training because he is currently finishing a patrol cruise on the Drake. That will allow us time to prepare you. Along with other techs of lower rank, Armorer Bond has been under surveillance for some time, and we have his DNA. Because this is a long mission, we will have to alter the medical records at Hamilton Base and those carried on board the Magellan. We cannot risk changes to the main databases, but the subroutine should hold unless there's a deep audit. Even so, that will require your escape relatively soon after the ship returns. Any other information you can supply will be most useful as well. Might I ask why an armorer? There are several reasons, Ebio replied. First, scrutiny of mid and lower level techs is somewhat less. Second, armorers have access to AG-driven message torps and regular armed torps. The torp drives have the components that can be converted to the necessary signaler. Do we know anything about where this place is? Distant enough to require several gates to reach it. The details will be covered in your briefing and indoctrination, Senior Operative Goodman, Truesdale said smoothly as he stood. I wish you well, Goodman. You're in Major Ibio's most capable hands now. Ibio had risen as well. Unlike the Colonel, he wasn't smiling. The Morning Star, the Hammer of Lucifer, or what the Sunnis called the Spear of Iblis. Why was the Colonel sending an operative? Why not a crusader who was deep-programmed? I could see why he didn't want to send a fleet directly against the Comity, especially when too many ships were tied up in finishing the pacification of the Librocracy. But a single operative? 3. Fitzhugh. After a long and frustrating battle with student preconceptions in the honor seminar about the reliability of standard historical methodologies, I stepped into my office in the history annex and took a long, deep breath. At times I did indeed have difficulty in refraining from applying violence to those prone to incompetence. Without thought, I dropped into an alert stance as a slender man in a black single suit rose from the chair in front of my desk console. I had sealed my office when I'd left for class. Easy, Professor Fitzhugh. John Harrit, Comity Security. I've been waiting for you. For me? I didn't even have to look puzzled. I hadn't seen a security type in years, if not decades, certainly not since I had finished the two service tours that had paid for my undergraduate and graduate degrees. But then those years and what they had entailed were best left in the past. For me? I'm afraid that I can't be of much help to you, or security. I couldn't help but wonder why so many security organizations wore black, or mostly black. Then the black was doubtless only used when they wanted to be noticed. I'm certain you'll be of great help, Harrit smiled almost apologetically. Before we go any further, though, I'd like to request that you check all your incoms. That will make some matters clearer, Professor. I didn't like his attitude, but I would have checked my incoms anyway, so I settled behind the console. The first message was from the dean congratulating me on my success in obtaining a senior fellowship with the Comity Diplomatic Corps and granting me up to a 3-year sabbatical, effective immediately at the end of the day, today. He also thanked me for obtaining the matching grant for my replacement, wished me well, and asked me to stop by for just a moment before I left. The next message was from the provost, both congratulating me and telling me how much the trustees would appreciate the outside validation of the expertise of the university faculty. The third message was from the resources office, noting that during my sabbatical, my pay would continue to be posted to my designated financial institution and that all coverages would remain in full force, in addition to any coverages that I might obtain through the Comity Fellowship. I looked at Harriet. Why don't you explain? You've been requested as a consultant on a high-level, extraordinarily secret Comity project. Ishuka said. It's so high-level that I don't know what it is or where it is. I'm supposed to accept without knowing anything. Actually, Professor, you really don't have any choice. As you can see from those messages, the government has already made the arrangements with the university system. You will receive your university salary during the sabbatical. In addition, you'll be paid at the rate of a Comity assistant underminister for the duration of the project, or a full academic year, whichever is longer. That was frightening. An assistant underminister made at least three times what I did, and anyone who wanted to pay me that much had either a difficult or dangerous task, or both. You're security, but this fellowship is with the diplomatic corps. Why are you here? You're a very important man, Professor. Why, I don't know. My job is to make sure you get to the project safely. So, do you have any recommendations on what I should take? My words came out sardonically. You'll be traveling, and that means packing light. I'd suggest as much material as you can load into a couple of cubes, a mixture of entertainment and professional reading. I'll have console and equipment access, or do I need to bring a portable console? I'm quite sure that you'll be provided with all the equipment you need, Professor. With your background, I'm certain you understand that. I ignored the reference to the service. That had been long ago, even if I did continue the workouts and exercises. They were useful to keep me in shape despite my more sedentary academic lifestyle. They also provided a most necessary outlet for a genetically supported tendency to violence, so that it didn't actually throttle dense students. What now? I'd suggest you say your goodbyes to the dean and then we go to your quarters and pack. We have a reservation on one of the late evening elevator climbers to Orbit Station Beta. While I'd had the feeling that the assignment was off-planet, since Leinster wasn't exactly the hub of Comity, Harriet's words still sent a chill through me. Where am I headed after that? I don't know. There will be a Comity courier ship waiting for you. That's all they told me. What do I tell my family? Your daughters are both grown and you never recontracted. You tell your daughters that you're leaving on this splendid fellowship and that it's a well-paid, once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. I have a comm address through which they can reach you. Carefully screened, no doubt. Very carefully screened, I'm certain, Professor. Harriet smiled. You'd best cube load whatever you want from your console here, and then I'll accompany you to see the dean. As if I had much choice. I should have rejected the nomination that had appeared weeks before, except I had the feeling that no one would have listened. And I still had no idea why I was being drafted or for what, only that the stakes had to be high. But why would anyone want an obscure professor of historical trends from the University of Gregory?
4. Chang. Headed back from the Alpha Station, I felt the ice forming on the back of the space armor collar. Brushed it away twice. Wouldn't want to have it jam the seal if I had to cram on the helmet. Cockpit heaters weren't working that well. Neither were the scrubbers. Frost was building on the bulkheads away from the boards. I triggered the comlinks. Tight beam. Flashpot stack or two on return. Cargo as manifested, no passengers.
Stack or two, have you inbound this time?
Affirmative. Idiot. On return had to be inbound.
Stack or two, shut down and report to ops upon return.
Flashpot, shift's not over.
Operational requirements, stack or two.
Stat, we'll report as ordered. Operational requirements meant I got paid. Wasn't about to let Gresham short me on a technicality. Didn't get paid enough as it was. Never had. Scanned the boards. The far screens and rep screens that worked. Telltales showed a ship at lock one. Priority lock. Couldn't tell what. IFF wasn't working. Not much on beta station shuttles did, except basic habitability, main controls, drives, grapples, and dampers. Why had worked suited, except for the helmet. McClendon was ass end of the Comity. No orbit elevators. Would have been cheaper and safer, but the tightwads wouldn't come up with the capital. Couldn't afford more than basic maintenance. Sometimes not even that. Another 10 standard passed before I confirmed Beta Station. Dead ahead. Would have been shocked if it hadn't been. Years since I missed on a straight in. Flashpot stacker 2, Havelock 5, visual and beacon. 2, cleared into lock, straight to ops after shutdown. Stat. What the frick did ops want? Shouldn't say ops. Gresham was ops, maintenance, and my boss. Went to work. Manual approach. Light touches on the steering jets. Quick burst on the electrographs. Shuttle settled against the dampers. Cargo and personnel locks lined up perfectly. Mag clamp sealed tight. Flashpot, 2's locked, shutting down this time. Stet, 2. Report off soonest. Didn't bother with a reply. First, logged red status to ops. Then had to do the shutdown checklist manually and by memory. Heads up had died 3 months back. No chance of repair. No one made McCann wafers anymore. Could feel more chill building in the cockpit before I unharnessed. Carried my helmet out of the shuttle. Westman stood by the lock, waiting. Red status, I told him. Reports in the station log. It's a wonder she stayed up so long, shook his head. Gresham won't be happy. He's never happy, Westman laughed. Made my way toward the lockers. Wasn't about to wear a suit longer than necessary. Stripped off the suit, racked the helmet. Pulled a vest and shorts over my skin tights and headed inward. Took the crew tube. Didn't see anyone. Not that likely at midnight Comity standard. Ops was on the inner ring, where the grav fields were steady. Cube 3 meters on a side. Gray walls. Gresham sat in a web chair. He swung away from the comm board and console when I stepped through the hatch. Looked at me, like he'd never seen me before. Before he said a word, I hit him. 2's down, heaters are shot, and scrubbers won't take out the water. Whole board to go in a long run, maybe even to Alpha.
We'll take care of that after you go, Chang. You've got one stand to pack your gear.
Gresham grinned. Evil expression. Wanted to smash his teeth in. Could have, too. Except I'd need work. Not going anywhere. Contract says...
I could tell you that you've been relieved because you're a lousy shuttle pilot. That wouldn't be true. Or I could say that I hate the waste you make of your looks, your arrogant fembitch attitude and your tight ass. That'd be true, but it's not the reason. Besides, run down as Beta Station is, I need good pilots, arrogant and tight-assed as they might be.
He grinned again.
You've got a better job.
That was bullshit. Who's gonna hire me?
That's the kind even you can't refuse, Chang.
Never been a job I couldn't walk away from. I'd walk to prove I could, if I had to.
The Comity Diplomatic Corps wants the best shuttle pilots. They were very specific. They tracked you down from that mess on Lear.
He grinned again.
I never knew you'd need a commissioner in the balls and broken all his fingers.
Bastard embezzled operation funds and tried to blame a maintenance failure on another pilot. He'd groped me too, but I wasn't about to tell Gresham. Gresham waited. So did I.
The Corps wants you. One Jiendra Chang. They told me to tell you 3 things. It's the toughest piloting job you or anyone else will ever see. You'll never hold any certification anywhere in the Comity if you don't take it. And you won't ever get off-planet to go anyplace else.
That's 2. Maybe it was 3, but he was holding something back. Frigging Comity. Hated threats.
The 3rd thing was a name. That's all. Eliasha Eileen Chuang.
Double frick. Tried not to react. Gresham leaned forward, looking uninterested. He wasn't. Who loaded you with all this shit?
Oh. And I was told to tell you that if you do this job right, you'll get back your star class rating and your deep space master cert. You'll also get paid at star class rates, whether you're successful or not, for a minimum of 1 year.
Talk about reward punishment. Whoever they were could break me, even in McClendon's system, but offered stuff only Comity execs could provide. Who said so?
The lady in black who's waiting out in the passageway. She arrived a little while ago on that Comity courier. It's an armed courier, Chang. Talk to her and go pack. Good luck. Even you'll need it.
Gresham turned back to the comm board. Not a signal on it. Just a way of telling me he was done. Stepped out into the passageway. She was 3 meters back. Wasn't smiling either. Who are you? Already knew what she was. Muscles, alertness, and black vest and shorts. Black skin tights said Comity Commando. Also meant they knew my background.
I'm Alia Podorovsky, Pilot Chang.
Pleasant voice. Behind it, she was the femme bitch Gresham thought I was. Where's this pilot job?
I don't know. My mission is to escort you onto the Comity courier waiting in the priority lock and get you to where we're headed. I suggest we go to your quarters and that you pack your gear. I doubt you have that many memorabilia.
Her eyes went over me like I was raw meat. Hate it when they do that, men or women.
5. Barna. Peter Atreos walked into the front display foyer. He stopped before the rendition of the Grand Opera Theater. After a moment, he shook his head. Without looking at me, he spoke. When I look at this, I see all the faults and none of the grandeur. Yet every detail is perfect. That was because the opera house was an architectural melange, a performing space designed to please the patrons, not to showcase the performers or the production. Atreos was one of those patrons. Why do you leave that work in the display foyer, Ser Barna? I shrugged. It is good art. Someday someone will buy it. You're a great artiste, but you are not a businessman. He planted himself before the replica of the hollow portrait of Renis Zafir. The original was in Zafir's private galley. Atreos studied it closely. His eyes narrowed. I knew why. Zafir had thick, bushy eyebrows that dominated his face. They gave him an unkempt look, even in the formal single suit. I could have cleaned up the eyebrows a touch, then the image would have reflected greater control of the power of Zafir's iron will, but not the passion behind it, or the humor, or the stubbornness. It still would have been Zafir, but not as much as Zafir. The original showed that to an even greater extent. Originals always do in a way that even a molecularly identical copy cannot, no matter what the scientific types say. That was why original works remained in demand. They always would. You have a reputation for talent and realism, Ser Barna, offered Atreos. That is what I'm known for. I could feel Ariana's eyes on my back. She stood at the railing of the loft. When potential clients appeared, so did she. She looked down into the display foyer. I always felt her eyes. What artist would not? Great realism. Atreos's words were tinged with irony. He turned and looked directly at me. Yet, realism, untempered by, shall we say, practical considerations, fails to serve the patron or the artist. It would be best for me to say little. Ariana was listening, and I knew what Atreos wanted. I nodded. You know that we are seeking a likeness of the new director. The work would provide a handsome commission. You did not submit a proposal. I am here, Ser Atreos. My work is known. If the Society General sees fit to commission me, I would be most honored. I offered the slightest bow. The Society General, Ser Barna, cannot offer commissions to those who do not apply, Atreos replied. The application deadline is tomorrow. You might wish to know. I bowed again. You are most kind and thoughtful.
I am not, Sir Barna. I would prefer not to deal with you. The others requested you be told. With a brusque nod, he turned and departed. He did not hurry, but he did not look back. His parting sentiment was not unexpected. That he had come to the studio at all had been the surprise.
Chendor!
Ariana walked down the ramp from the loft. Her deep blue eyes flashed. Her jet black hair was shoulder length, most unfashionable, but perfect for her wide forehead, oval face, and high cheekbones. She was angry, but I enjoyed watching her before she spoke.
You turned him down. You are an idiot, Chendor, an idiot. You are a great artist, but you are an idiot. You are less than an idiot. You are an arrogant, artistic genius, and we will all starve because you never compromise.
Ariana's words burned. They always did. She was exaggerating. I had the studio, and it was on Rambo Boulevard with an eight-room conapt behind it. We owned both in fee simple without encumbrances. We could afford the academy for Nicole. That was hardly starving in Nouveau Rochelle, the city of the arts on Gallia. I do not see you subsisting on stale biscuits, my dear. After 20 years, she was more beautiful than ever, and some of the portraits of her in the conapt would take away the breath of the most jaded. They were not for others, but for me. I would destroy them in time, but not for many years.
You are impossible.
That is possible, I admitted. Will you never reach out to ask for a commission? Atreus does not want me. The others do. They forced him to come here and ask you to offer a proposal. Anything I painted would not satisfy him. I would not have one of the most powerful financiers in New Rochelle dissatisfied with me.
His satisfaction will never pay the bills.
That is most true, my dear, but his dissatisfaction may keep others from paying them.
You are impossible.
I believe you said that before. I smiled broadly.
Chendor, I don't know why I stay with you.
Because I am an arrogant artistic genius, and because I love you. I have always loved you and looked at no one else.
All that is true, Chendor, but don't you dare turn down another paying commission that good. Don't you dare.
I can't promise that, dearest. Ariana was shaking her head as she walked up the ramp to the upper level from where she managed the financial side of the studio. She was no longer angry. That I could tell. Should I offer a proposal on the Société Générale portrait? It would be simple enough, and the work would not be that hard. Then again, Atreus would tell everyone he knew in Nouveau Rochelle all of the faults he saw in the portrait. He knew far more people than I did. If I created a portrait that pleased Atreus, it would not be the kind of work for which I was known. I would then be accused of abandoning my standards. That could cost me more than I'd gain from the Société Générale Commission. I looked up from my thoughts. Out beyond the front display window, a black sedan glided to a stop at the curb in front of the studio. It was a security vehicle. I recognized it because one had always followed Zafir's limousine when he had come to sit for his portrait. I'd offered to go to his office. He had said that he preferred the excuse of leaving it. Two men got out of the sedan and stepped toward the studio door. It was going to be one of those days. Ariana would be anything but pleased if I turned down a second commission, especially from someone wealthy enough for a security detail. When they stepped into the front foyer, I bowed. Greetings. As I straightened up, I recognized the shorter man in the lighter gray. It was Georges Hilaire, the managing director of Banque du Nord. I'd done a portrait of his wife 9 years back. It had been one of my better works, except for those of Ariana, of course. Sir Barna. That was the taller and younger man in the severe dark gray single suit. He had the figure of someone who had been an athlete and still kept in training. His eyes drifted to the representation of the Grand Opera Theater. He nodded and his eyes flicked back to me. They were dark gray. They were also far harder than I would have expected from a man who looked so young as he did. The same. I apologize, he went on. Sir Hilaire had given me your name and had agreed to accompany me. I'm here to discuss a possible commission. The hesitation over the word commission suggested tentativeness, but Hilaire would never have accompanied someone who could not have afforded my work and prices. We would appreciate a few minutes with you, perhaps in a less open space. Some clients were like that. The conference room is damped. I gestured for them to follow me.
Neither spoke until the door was closed. One of them added a secondary damping field. Hilaire wouldn't have done it. The younger man in the darker gray surveyed the octagonal chamber, with the cherry-paneled walls and no artwork. He studied the piped light chandelier, then the circular table, before seating himself in one of the four wooden armchairs. I took the chair across from him. Hilaire sat at my left. He worried his lip with his lower teeth. I'd not seen that before. "I am here on behalf of both the Comity Cultural Service and the Diplomatic Corps," began the man I didn't know. "You didn't say who you are," I offered. "I could give you a name. It wouldn't be mine, but you could track it, and it would be real. As real as any name is, and it would even identify the company that pays my salary. It's not real either, except as a financial entity." "Why didn't you just give it, then?" "Because Sir Hilaire suggested I do not. He said that you would know it was not real. Our research indicates the same. That talent is part of the reason the Comity would like to offer you both a stipend and a series of works for a commission. The stipend would go to your wife, the commission to you." "I'm certain Ariana would agree to that," I laughed. "She might ask why both did not go to her." The corners of Hilaire's lips lifted, then dropped. "What is this commission?" "A series of depictions of places and items of great and unique interest. I can only say that you have never seen their like." "Can only say or will only say. I cannot say more because I don't know more." He was telling the truth. That was interesting and unnerving. "The stipend would be 5,000 Comity credits, paid every galleon month for up to 3 years. That was even more unnerving. Over the past decade, my best year had been 70,000, my worst 30. The Comity was offering a baseline stipend of 50,000. "And the commission?" "An additional 100,000 baseline, up to 300,000. "I don't recall such generosity being a Comity policy. What conditions are you omitting?" "You'll be traveling on Comity vessels, not luxurious private transports. The work will be interesting but demanding. It could take up to 2 years. You will have comm links, but they will be delayed and monitored. Most important, if you take the assignments, Sir Barna, you'll have to leave within a standard day. We will need to know your decision by the end of the day." "And if I don't accept?" "We go to the second artist on the list. That's a Pieter Bunev. He's from Dnipro." Bunev was good, but not so good as I was. The man in dark gray knew that. He also knew I wouldn't like to give such an opportunity to Bunev. "You may have my decision now." Hilaire frowned. I could tell he thought I would decline. "I will accept on one condition." "I don't have much latitude, Sir Barna. At least 20% of the work must be mine to display as I see fit and to sell or resell freely." He nodded. "If you'll excuse me for a moment, I will need to check with my superior." He stood and walked out, clearly heading toward the security sedan and its shielded communications. After the other left the conference room, Hilaire studied me. He had an air of gloom. "Must you always be difficult, Chendor?" "Artists are. No matter how great what I am to portray may be, and no matter how well I depict it, it does me no good if it is sealed in the Comity archives. It will not do the Comity much good either." "Chendor, you always press too much. You could have the Society's General Commission if you would but submit a proposal." "Georges, that is begging, and I cannot beg." "Cannot or will not?" "I cannot. You know that." "All too well. That will be the death of you." Or the making, and the line between the two was thin for an artist. We waited. Shortly, the gray man returned. His lips held a faint smile as he closed the conference room door behind him. He did not seat himself. 20% is acceptable, but nothing that will reveal military or technological details. I have been assured that you will have a great deal of choice within those parameters, perhaps more than you would wish or imagine." There it was. Take it or leave it. Risk portraying dull images for a high fee or... I almost laughed. The images in Nouveau Rochelle were already getting dull. When else would I get a chance such as this? Even before I replied, the unnamed man knew I could not risk not having a chance at whatever it was that the Comity wanted represented accurately and artistically. "I accept." "Good.
I will see you an hour before noon tomorrow. You are limited to one large valise for clothing and no more than 100 kilos for equipment. For the range of what I might have to depict, 100 kilos might be pushing it. But if I eased in another 10, I bet no one would complain. I intended to take everything from old-style oils, pastels, and charcoal to light brushes. The canvases and the light matrices would be the heaviest, but I could always roll some canvases into my valise and limit the frames. Sir Hilaire will be here an hour before I arrive to set up the financial details. The monthly stipend to your wife will be coming through Bank du Nord, and the first payment will be in the designated account before you leave, as will half of the minimum commission. I walked them to the studio door. When I turned and headed back, I could see Ariana coming down the ramp. I've taken a commission. I thought as much. Her words were tired. I have to travel off-planet for it. You turn down a perfectly good commission here in Nouveau Rochelle, then take one that will send you off-planet. Chendor, I do not understand you. A stipend of 5,000 a galleon a month for you for at least a year and a deposit of 50,000 in advance. Both will be paid tomorrow before I leave.
You're leaving tomorrow? For a year?
Her voice rose.
What about me? What about Nicole?
Ariana, this is an urgent commission from the Comity Diplomatic Corps. It is so important that they have pressured Georges Hilaire to accompany them. You would have me turn down Hilaire? They must have discovered something of great import, an abandoned colony or perhaps the first alien artifacts. My work will be displayed across all the world of the Comity. Peter Atrios would look like a fool if he opposed my work. They will beg me.
Chendor, those who have any taste already do.
This is the chance of a lifetime.
What will you be portraying?
Everything.
Exactly what is everything?
Ariana's words were measured. They said that they couldn't tell me.
You believed them?
Georges Hilaire was with them. The funds are coming through Bank du Nord. Besides, who would pay 55,000 credits if they did not want my art? Even Ariana knew that a contract disposal could be had for far less, should anyone wish to remove me. Tears appeared in the corners of her eyes. You said I shouldn't turn down another good commission.
Chendor, I didn't mean...
Her arms were around me. That was the best we could do. 6. Goodman Bond. The face in the fresher mirror was still unfamiliar, long and horsey. The short hair was brown, wiry, and curly enough to be unpleasantly unmanageable. I was glad for the short military cut. The skin was too dark for my taste, but not out-and-out black or even light mahogany. After the survey and another effort to become familiar with the new visage, I stepped from the small fresher into the single room of the Pleasure Girl studio. I was William Gerald Bond. Before long, I would be the only William Gerald Bond. At the faint beep, I checked the locator. It showed that the girl was on the ramp headed up to the studio. I stepped behind the old-style hinge door. The bioplastic had been re-smoothed and colored so many times that faint streaks of white discolored what had been solid brown. Waiting for them to arrive, I thought about the last month. When I'd come out of the nanite cocoon, my head felt like it had been split, frozen, and pulverized. The result? I now knew more about being a comedy armorer than I'd ever wished. I also knew how to build an Atrusan graviton signaler. Major Abayo hadn't left that mere nanite in dock. I'd built three before he and his chief tech were satisfied, all except for a live power source. We'd used inactive ones. Wouldn't do to set off an AC signaler in New Jerusalem. I couldn't say I knew how it worked, only what components to use and how to put them together. I'd also had to practice repairs and diagnostics until my fingers and hands matched my mind. You're tougher than Colonel Truesdale thought. That was what Major Abayo had said at my last briefing. How many others didn't make it? I'd asked. For this position, you were the only choice. That meant Abayo had planted others, or hoped to. After all the in-depth conditioning and training, I'd still had to get to Hamilton. The first stage had been the most tedious, as a tourist going to the pleasure spa at May West. An identity switch, and I'd been Angus DeVille, natural fabrics factor, on the way home to Hamilton. Now I was in Alexander, the city that had grown up around the Comity's military orbit elevators, and I stood behind a bioplastic door waiting for an oversexed armor and a lightly conditioned pleasure girl. You know what the steps ahead are, but you don't think about them and not about the big picture. You can go crazy doing that, especially if it involved the Comity getting its hands on the Morning Star. You think about what is next and how to react. The door was thick enough that I didn't hear anything until they were just outside, and she touched the ID block. Just a moment, big boy, not in the hall. A nervous laugh followed the words. The door opened and I lifted the stunner. As the door closed, I hit Bond with a full nerve jolt, then dropped the intensity to stun before I triggered it a second time. Neither even had a chance to see me. Two bodies lay on the floor, one dead and one unconscious. I straightened the girl, then dragged Bond's form across the floor and into the fresh air. There I stripped off his uniform. Once I had the uniform off, I carried it out of the fresh air and into the other room, laying it across one of the straight-backed chairs set on each side of the small table protruding from the wall. Then I came back and stripped off his underwear before hauling the body into the shower drainage basin. I didn't look at his face. I knew better. I had to wash the underdrawers. Distasteful, but necessary. I hung them on the clothing pegs on the back of the door. Before I went further, I pulled on the double-layered, impermeable gloves, then turned the water on in the sink as hot as possible. Only then did I take out the packet and slide it under the stream of water, just long enough for the outer film to turn red. I quickly placed the packet on the chest of the dead man and stepped back to the sink. There I let the water run over the gloves before I stripped off the outer layer, then the inner one. I left the fresher and closed the door behind me. The pleasure girl was still out, but breathing normally. I glanced back at the closed fresher door. The packet had held special nanites, gray goo, so to speak, special gray goo, designed only to dissolve certain kinds of cells and to be active only for so long. Still, I wasn't about to step back into the fresher until that time was well past. Well past. I crossed the room to where the pleasure girl lay. With a smile, I bent and lifted her, carrying her to the bed against the wall. I laid her out on it so that she'd be comfortable. She was pretty enough, and my new eye had paid for her services. There was no reason not to enjoy them. It would certainly be in character, and I'd be gentler than Bond was known to have been. I'd just tell her the truth, that she'd fainted as she'd stepped into the studio. I didn't have to mention that I'd caused her to faint. The priors might not be happy when I was debriefed, and the adjudicators wouldn't be pleased, but I could always claim that I'd had to stay in character as part of my mission. In another 15 minutes, well before she woke, I'd have to go back into the fresher and rinse out the residue in the shower basin.
7. Chang. Never got planetside after the courier left McClendon Alpha Station. Alia stuffed me into a clamshell in the courier's passenger closet, boosted out system at 3 Gs. Couriers don't use full grav protection. Too much mass. Went through the outsystem gate like a hellbat. Only dropped XL for pre-gate and gate. I'd held star class, but wouldn't have tried that. Definite way of putting me in my place. Stupid, too. Hit the edge of a gate and you become instant singularity. Maybe even a graviton wave. That's after the explosion, the hard radiation, and the general mess within light hours. No one asked me. Courier docked somewhere. I pulsed the links. Where are we? We're locked at a DSS station in the outer fringes of the Hamilton system. The exact locale is classified. You can release the clamshell. I used the inside controls to open the clamshell. Once clear, I looked around. No one anywhere, but words projected from the overhead. Your gear is short of the lock. Leave by yourself. You'll be met. Good luck, sweetie. The voice was Alia's. Hot pilot, but a definite femme. Made my way to the lock. My one kit bag sat there. Took my time checking the pressure equalizations and temps before I opened the inner hatch and picked up my kit. Fog still formed when the lock hatch slid open. Next hatch was to the station. Checked it more carefully. Indicators green. Opened the hatch and stepped across. More fog, and the faint acrid smell all asteroid stations had. Oil and metal and ozone and people. Even nanite-based reformulators never get rid of everything. Faint grav shift. That told me one thing. The station was an asteroid type. Most likely nickel iron with tunnels. easy to shield. Gray-haired Comity DSS commander met me outside the station lock. Wore the standard blue skin tights and gray vest and shorts for stations and ships.
"You're Jiendra Chang,"
I nodded. Once.
"I'm Commander David Morgan. I'm the operations officer of the Magellan. You've been assigned to us, but the ship isn't quite ready for us to embark."
He smiled, half sympathetic and half hard as adamantine steel.
"There's another aspect of your job no one told you. From this moment on, you're Lieutenant Chang, and you're under my command. Your pay is still civilian star class, but the Magellan is the equivalent of a battlecruiser, and all the pilots are in the military chain of command."
Shit. I thought dealing with Gratian was tight ass. Military was worse. "Yes, sir."
"Come with me. I'll try to answer your questions, those that I can."
He turned. I followed. Gravity was at 1T, or close enough. Passageway was melted through the asteroid. Deck was smooth and even. Bulkheads and overhead weren't. Station wasn't regular installation then. "Commander, was the station created for this mission?"
"That's an interesting question."
He didn't look back.
"You tell me why you think so, and I'll tell you if you're right."
"The deck is smooth. Bulkheads and overheads aren't. Be hard to believe that of a regular DSS installation." He laughed.
"You're right."
"What is the mission?"
"I can't tell you that until later."
He stopped at an unmarked hatch and touched his hand to the scanner. Hatch opened silently. Old hatches weren't that quiet. Morgan's office was smaller than Gratian's cube on Alpha Station. Morgan dropped into a chair, gestured to the other one. Didn't feel like sitting, but didn't feel like carrying the kit bag longer either. So I sat and waited for him to tell me something I didn't know. He grinned, almost friendly.
"DSS hijacked you. Get used to the rank. You'll be using it for a long time, if you make it. If you don't, you'll still get star-class salary while you're here and your ratings back. That is, if you don't knee anyone or smash their kneecaps."
Wondered how he'd found out about the kneecap incident. Had to have been 15 years back. I waited.
"We need particular skills in shuttle pilots. Most DSS pilots will handle vessels in deep space far better than any of you could ever hope. Most of you can handle small craft around stations, planets, and other moving bodies far better than your DSS compatriots. Different skills, and we need the best of both."
He paused.
"You'll start specialized training tomorrow, along with Lieutenant Braun. She'll be here in a moment to show you around the station and help you get squared away. She was the first shuttle pilot here. You two will be sharing a stateroom here. You'll have your own onboard ship."
Didn't want to share anything. Didn't know which was worse, sharing with men or women. Just different problems. "How long before we embark on the Magellan?"
"I can't say. That depends on too many variables. Between 2 and 4 standard weeks. You'll be busy enough not to worry."
"Can you tell me what I'll be piloting?"
"A very special shuttle that also is configured as a lander with unique capabilities. Don't ask me to describe those. You'll begin to learn all about them tomorrow."
A slight beep from the hatch indicated someone outside. The hatch slid open. Morgan stood. Figured I'd better too. Woman who stepped in was the kind whose looks I hated. Petite, creamy skin, dark mahogany hair. Doll-like. Might have come to my shoulder.
"Lieutenant Braun, this is Lieutenant Chang."
Morgan smiled, professionally polite. "Greta Braun," she turned to me. Black eyes like focused particle beams. I've seen cold. Hers were colder. Jiendra Chang, the commander cleared his throat.
Lieutenants, it's 1500. I don't expect to see either of you until 0800 tomorrow at the training bay. That's Bay 3.
Yes, sir. Bronn's voice was polite. Pleasant. Yes, sir. We walked out into the passageway. Except for us, it was empty. Bronn looked at me.
I have to ask.
Her voice was level, warmer than her eyes. Anything would have been. Did you really break all of Fingon's fingers? No, broke 6, maybe 7. They stunned me before I got the last 3. How do you know him? I didn't. I took the job after you left. I made head pilot a year back. What happened to Hengeist? He had an accident and decided to leave. Hengeist had been almost as bad as Fingon. Should have had an accident earlier. How did you manage it?
I didn't. I just didn't try to save him very quickly.
I'd have bet Bronn had done more than that. Also bet that it wasn't wise to say so. Suppose you ought to give me the tour.
I can do that, she paused. I'd like to have one thing clear. No men or women in the stateroom.
That was fine by me. You hadn't suggested it, I would have. That got me a nod. Bronn turned and began to walk. This passageway is upper operations, only for ops personnel, pilots and ops techs. That's why it's mostly quiet. Ops passageways are gray, the same as on DSS ships. Crew passages are blue. Maintenance ways are brown, and the weapons spaces are red. Pilots can use any passageway, but it's best to avoid maintenance unless there's no other way. I followed, listening.
8. Fitzhugh. Miles' security agent Herod had been absolutely accurate in all that he had said. He had not said more than that I was to be handled like a valuable and high-priority package, and that was exactly what occurred. We were sequestered in a luxury lounge on the elevator climber to Orbit Station Beta. Orbit elevators represented the cost-effective and practical, but there's little doubt that they de-elated the romance of flight, leaving it far less supernal, assuming it ever had been. We sat in the private lounge, a space no more than 3 meters square, adjoining 2 even smaller bedchambers. Featherlight hangings of cream and blue framed the wall screen that showed Leinster slowly dwindling below us, and the stars appearing as the elevator accelerated upward out of the lower atmosphere. There was a stripped-down console between our chairs, and I could have read, but I felt even less like reading than watching Leinster, especially with Agent Herrett around. For me, reading has always been solitary. I tried music, an ancient piece, the 1812 Overture. I blocked the visuals. Battle scenes recreated with brilliant blue-trimmed red uniforms and prancing mounts disconcerted me too much, but entertainment multis weren't about to show filthy blue and white uniforms with barefoot soldiers leaving bloody footprints. Almost no one listened to music without a visual component anyway. I was one of the remaining few who preferred the auditory over the visual. Eventually I went to bed, but didn't sleep that well. Herod was awake and dressed in his black single suit before me in the morning and waited in the small lounge after I'd freshened up. The mostly waterless way, since water has mass, and every ton of water means a ton less paying cargo or passengers. The eggs Lyonnaise from the lounge formulator were patrician in style and presentation, but thoroughly formulated in taste, and I eased them down with the excessive caffeine of old-style bergamot tea, also formulated. After beginning my second mug of the ersatz stuff, I looked across the narrow pop-up table that separated us, for Herod had said nothing. How many missions like this have you done, conveying professors to unknown destinations? Ensuring the safe arrival of people and items is one of our standard duties, Professor. You of all academics should know that. How long have you been with Comity Security?
A number of years.
How many people have you injured or killed? He just looked at me. I knew what he was thinking. Violence on the personal level was a sign of incompetence. Have you had to take special precautions in my case? Herod laughed.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.